Perhaps the least unexpected thing about this year's Mercury nominations is that the most unexpected am of the year is already the 4-1 joint favourite to win. Where are we now? Where are we now? David Bowie's The Next Day crept out without any fanfare at the start of the year. Well, without any fanfare. As soon as it emerged, there was an awful lot of fanfare. And it was hailed as a great return to form, so it's no surprise to see that one instantly topping the bookies' charts. It would be nicer if the Mercury Music Prize was just a genuine representation of the 12 best albums of the year. There's no room for Mumford & Sons or Bastille, who were two of the big commercial successes of the year in British music. And perhaps most interestingly, dance music isn't as strongly represented as one might have expected. This year's reports from Reading and Leeds Festival in The Guardian highlighted the crowds flocking to see the dance acts and noted the empty tents watching traditional bread and butter guitar bands. But it's still those guitar bands who make up the bulk of the Mercury Music Prize shortlist this year.
Savages have made the Mercury shortlist because their album was quite a genuinely exciting moment, I think, in 2013. They were really aggressive and angry, and I thought that was really exciting and really important for bands to be doing that still. I don't think that Savages represent any kind of section of music at the moment. I think they are quite independent of any kind of trends, but I think that's why they're unique and good. I don't think Savages' style of music is the reason why they should win or have been nominated. I think it's what they're doing and the way that they're doing it that's important. And I do think, although they are women, that's not a reason for them to win, but it would be the first time that an all-female band would have won a Mercury. There's
an end to your love. So I think James Blake is on the shortlist because he's managed to combine aspects of British dance music with soul, garage, techno. He's managed to put those things all together and create an album which is complete, ambitious, and kind of it achieves what it's supposed to achieve. The fact that, you know, he can kind of transcend the world of dance music, go into a kind of polite society, if you will, but still have a bit of an edge. I mean, some of the tracks, like Digital Lion, which is produced with Brian Eno, is basically just a techno song. He's stayed true to his roots, but kind of, still managed to kind of get to the dinner party crowd. There she waits, looking for a saviour,
someone to save her from a dying self. I think Lauren Vula has made the Mercury shortlist just because Sing to the Moon is a really incredible album offering. I think we've probably come to expect a little bit more from the female vocal in British music. And I think that Lauren Vula kind of really gives something different in that there's very rich, very soulful, Jill Scott-esque vocals against a backdrop of jazz and soul, and you know, there's moments of real euphoria on the album and there's moments of real melancholy, which I think is what really makes this album great. Morning, it's another pure grey morning. Don't know what the day is holding.
And I get up right home and I walk right into the path of a lightning bolt. Obviously, there's a lot of debate around the authenticity of the record. You know, I think it comes from him slagging off lots of pop acts for not being authentic, and then his music, obviously he's written it with a co-songwriter. I don't think many people care less about that really in the wider world. I think it's just something critics like to talk about. I think one interesting thing you can say about the authenticity debate is that I think it does reflect in his music that he doesn't quite know who he is yet as a musician. He doesn't know if he wants to be Bob Dylan. There's kind of lots of kind of classic 60s style songs. He doesn't know if he wants to be a bit more rebellious. Like, you know, he's a 19-year-old from a council estate in Nottingham, and some songs on the album, like Two Fingers, about kind of smoking weed, running from the police, that kind of thing. So, you know, I think he's just a bit confused who he is as an artist. It doesn't really tell you much about the music scene in 2013, which I think a good Mercury album should do. The Mercury seems to get more and more mainstream each year, more and more in kind of trend with what people are buying, or tries to at least. So it could win, but I just think it'd be a very bad choice if it did.
Alt J for their album An Awesome Wave.
Recently, there seems to just be this trend of the last 10 years where the Mercury doesn't seem to represent music as much as just like kind of this almost like enemy guitar indie world, which it never really used to do when it started, but the last kind of 10 years it's been doing, and it was fine for a bit because they were the records that were the most interesting. They were like dominating the kind of the trends and the tastes of that time. But nowadays I don't think people are really listening to indie guitar bands in quite the same way, and yet they still seem really overrepresented on the list. So for that reason, you know, Alt J won it last year, and I don't feel like Alt J were the most exciting band of last year.